Hi, so you're here because you're interested in HPC storage and how it compares to traditional enterprise storage, network attached storage in particular. So my name's Curtis Anderson, I work for Panasas. I've been doing storage software for 33 years now. So I'm going to go through some of the architecture behind the different options you have available, commercial products that you can purchase today, and why those architectures actually have an impact on your decisions. So here we have a traditional legacy NAS architecture. NAS started in the 90s, and about year 2000 is when HPC NAS started to separate itself out from all of the other uses of NAS. So in this legacy, we've got clients, we've got a NAS head, we've got RAID controllers and disk drives. Now the NAS head here is the interesting part because originally one computer was more than sufficient, but over time with the growth of capacity and the bandwidth required, the one computer wasn't enough. So about the year 2000, everyone in the industry tried to figure out how do we use what we now call today scale out, apply multiple computers to the problem. And like I said, I'll use NetApp as an example of one architecture, Isilon as an example of an architecture, and then Panasas, and go through the details of why it was constructed that way and what effect that has on the behavior, the performance of the system. So we're now going to go through the NetApp architecture and how they've addressed scale out. So in 99 or so, a company called Spinnaker Networks was founded, developed some scale out technology. NetApp purchased them in 03. Took them about till 2016 or so to produce a full-featured version that included all those features into ONTAP. This is the architecture that results. I'll go through what it, how it works. So the first things are back to our diagram. We've got clients, we've got NAS heads, hard drives, and a back-end network, and I'll explain each of the different pieces. So the NAS heads, there was a hardware RAID engine in the legacy architectures. They moved that up into software, but they put it at the bottom of their software stack. So that meant that a RAID group had to be entirely connected to this one node. You couldn't span RAID groups across nodes. So hard drives are dual ported. You can purchase them dual ported. So that's connected to this node and connected to this node over here. What that means is you really do have a pairwise structure where there's a pair here and a pair there. Their cluster, their scale-out cluster, is really a group of pairs. So what that means in terms of dollars and cents is they tell you to provision at 50% in order to avoid a performance hit when, or if and when one of these nodes were to fail. What that means in practice is that this guy is only half used. If this were to fail, this guy could take over both sets of drives, but without, if you don't want a performance hit, you only provision for 50%. You're buying twice as much NAS head hardware as you need in order to have that, the advantage of that no performance loss. So the other characteristic about this architecture is let's follow the data. You start here at a client, it comes into a NAS head. If the data is local, you go to the drives, you send it back. Life is good. But if you come in and the data is not here, you go across the network to this guy. He processes it, goes to that hard drive, comes back out, comes back across this network to this guy, and then back to the client. That's actually fairly expensive in terms of the latency that these NAS heads apply, because they're not Ethernet switches, they're software, so they take a long time to do some things, and the cost of the network, dedicated network structure behind the nodes. What you get is an architecture that's fairly good at some things, but not terribly efficient for an HPC workload. So now we're gonna go through Isilon. So Isilon was started in about 99, 2000, the same as the other companies we're talking about here. They were purchased by EMC in 2010 and now part of Dell. They took a slightly more aggressive approach to the architecture than Spinnaker Networks did. So rather than when they moved the hardware RAID engine up into their software stack, they did the same, but instead of putting it at the bottom of the software stack, they moved it deeper into the file system. So instead of having a RAID group that was necessarily contained within this node, their RAID is actually spread across all the nodes, distributed. So it's more like erasure coding that you would see in a more modern architecture. So they don't have the pairwise requirement the same way NetApp does today. They still have the back-end network. Talked about that in a second. The RAID groups mean that this node and all of its hard drives can fail, and the system, or could fail, and the system will continue to serve data because the other pieces of that RAID group are spread across the other nodes. So let's follow the data. Assume a client comes into the node. If all the data it wants is here, great. But if it issues a large read and some of the data is here and some of the data is over there, it has to do the same thing. A request comes through this software, over here, into this computer, out to that, back through the back-end network, and up to the client. And the back-end network is just as heavy as it was in the NetApp case. It's just we don't have the pairwise requirement. It works great for some things. It's, as you can see, there are inefficiencies. The dedicated network and the cost of provisioning that is an issue sometimes. It's a capable architecture, but we believe there's better. So now we're going to do the Panasas architecture. Panasas was founded in 1999, and it focused on the HPC market from the beginning. In order to meet the performance and scale requirements of that market, we've developed a parallel direct file system. There are no NAS heads in the traditional sense in our architecture. We've separated the problem into metadata processing and bulk user data. We have nodes that are dedicated to metadata processing. We call them directors. And we have nodes in our architecture that are dedicated to storage processing. You can choose however many of each you want in your cluster. We're showing 2 and 8 in this particular example. In the life of a client that wants to open a file, the client is going to come to the director node and say, I want to open this file. The director node is going to hand back, OK, great, here are the storage blades that are handling your file. We take each file, we stripe it across a set of the storage blades, not all of them, just a subset. And the map says which subset that is. The client then will access those storage blades directly. That's why we call it a direct file system. There's no NAS heads in between the client and its data. And it'll access them in parallel. That's why we call it a parallel file system. So the client will go to those storage blades and get a bunch of data back very quickly in parallel and directly. The way we stripe our data across the storage blades allows us to do erasure coding across those storage blades as well. That leads to linear scalability in our rebuild performance as well as in our data performance. So we've compared the three architectures. I hope I've illustrated how the architecture of a storage system can have a very large impact on the performance and the behavior of that system, how well it meets your needs. If you have questions, please contact us at panasas.com.